your bulletins, you see that the title of the message is Against Insurmountable Odds. And I used Judges chapter 6 and chapter 7 for this, but if you would put a note in there, this is part one of more than one message. I hope maybe to do it in two messages, and I won't be here next week, of course, but we'll pick it up week after next. But I was thinking, you know, as when I come to this familiar time in the scriptures where the people of God, God's people, Israel, had done some things, and they were separated, and he calls Gideon. Of course, we remember the story, but we're going to look at it again. But I wanted us to look at, and the reason I did not put the text up here is because I'm going to be sort of doing a tap dance through it. Some of the verses I will be paraphrasing, and some of them I will be, you know, I'll read. But if you have your Bibles, you need to be in chapter 6, and we will go probably through at least verse 24, a little after, maybe even a little further than that. Yeah, we'll go a little further than that. But anyway, we'll go through at least verse 24 of it. But before we do, let's go back to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you and adore you, and we thank you. We thank you for your word. And we thank you, Lord, that there are times that things look so impossible in our eyes, but they're not in yours. That you're a God of miracles. When we think it's in, that it can't happen, you just say, stand back and watch. And Lord, I pray that you would be with us today as we look at your word. And we begin to look at your call upon an individual. And Lord, we thank you so much. For it's in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. In chapter 6 of Judges, verse 1, it says this: And the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord delivered them into the hands of the Midians for 7 years. Wow. You know, we see that here that the people had turned away from God in our Sunday school lesson today, and a little after in our prayer request, we talked about how a nation can turn away from God. And we see that the nation of Israel here had turned away from God. And there was the Midians had come in and were there for 7 years. And the reason of it is what they had turned away from. And they had told, God had told the people, we see in verse 10, that he said, told them not to fear or worship the gods of the Amorites when they went into this promised land. But they didn't listen. They did that. Matter of fact, we look a little bit further down in verse 26, and we see that they had not only began to worship them, but they built altars unto Baal. And they had the poles, or the timbers that are raised up there, that Asherah poles, which is a mother goddess of Asherah, is who that is referring to there, and that they were almost like a totem pole that was lifted up. And they had done these things. They had brought the people into that, the people had got involved in it. And in verses 2 through 5, it says that the Midianites and the Amalekites and the children of the east invaded their land in vast numbers and were plummeting it and were destroying it. Their crops that were planted, they would camp out upon and destroy. The cattle and the livestock that they had would be destroyed by these people that had invaded the country. And it talks about them being a great multitude, and even the camels. At one point it talks about you couldn't count the camels that they had, that they were like the locusts of the field. God's people were so afraid of what was going on that they had began to disperse and go into the mountains and to live in the caves on the side of the mountains there that would be for protection and to stay away from the Midianites, and because they were afraid of what's going on and strongholds that was there. It talks about that in verse 2. It says, and the hand of the Midianites prevailed against the Israelites, Israel, and because of the Midianites, the children of Israel made them dens, which are in the mountains, and caves, and strongholds. I remember when I went to Israel, there was a little village that we had went to and spent the night at that was way south of Jerusalem and Hebron, and it was more of a real rural community called Etwana. And anyway, that village still people were living in caves. Now they would build a little entrance to it out of rock or stone and a roof over it, but they would live in the caves. And the interesting thing about it is their animals shared the same cave a lot of times. It was an interesting thing to see there. But here we see that the people had turned away from God. And when they turned away from God, the Midianites came in and was destroying and plummeted everything that was going on. I believe that this country that we live in has indeed been blessed by our Lord and Savior. I believe with all my heart that His hand has been upon it. We can see evidence of His hand moving throughout the times. I remember one that time that the Continental Army or the in the Revolutionary War, they had went over into Brooklyn, and the British Army was so strong, there was probably a third more of the British soldiers as they began to close in toward George Washington and his troops were. And it was, I think he had about 19,000 troops there. And they was going to try to escape because they were so vastly outnumbered. And there was no wind, so the British troops could not come up the river to stop from going across the river. So at night they began to go across the river. But it was so many of them that they could not make it across the river. So in the morning, as the sunlight began to come up, a fog came over the river. And as the fog was there, the soldiers went through on boats, rowed across the river into safety. And when the fog lifted, the British found none of the troops there. What I didn't say about that is that at least in one rendering of this, George Washington commanded his men to pray the night before. Pray for a way out because they were under attack. But let us go just a little bit more. It says in verse 7 that the people, says, and it came to pass that, well, let me go up to verse 6. And Israel was greatly impoverished because of the Midianites. And the children of Israel cried unto the Lord. And it came to pass when the children of Israel cried out to the Lord because of the Midianites. And we listen to this. The key word that I want to go off here is when. When. Do you get that? That when they cried, God heard and began to do something. Do you remember what I said in verse 1 of that? That there had been 7 years that God gave them over to the Midianites. I wonder why people would wait 7 years to come cry out to God. Why do we as a people, even when we see the things that are going on, when we see what is happening in our world, why do we wait so long to begin to cry out to God? And I believe that happens in our lives as individuals too. That even in our anointing, the anointing service for healing never says that you got to be deadly ill or on your deathbed before you got to have an anointing. And it says that when you're sick, when you're afflicted, to call for the elders of the church. Not to wait. You don't have to wait until all else fails. Because God is at a key point. But for some reason, you know, we choose to suffer a long time. There's a sermon that I used to give at camp a lot and I've done it a couple of times, and I may have done it here years ago, another night with the frogs, where they come to Pharaoh, and Pharaoh says, yeah, I pray thee, Moses, for you to go to your God and ask these frogs to be gone. And Moses says, well, when I pray thee, would you like for me to have the frogs removed? He says, tomorrow. Yeah, another night. I want to spend another night with those frogs. And that's what it sounded like here. Gideon receives in verse 8 and following on down. Gideon receives a visitor from heaven. As the angel of the Lord sees Gideon in verse 12, and he calls him a mighty man of valor, is what it says in the King James. And in NIV it says that he is a mighty warrior. That's the way God sees him. But look at how Gideon sees himself in verse 15. He says, my clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least of my family. And that is in NIV again there where I quoted that from. He is hiding in a wine press, threshing wheat because he is afraid. His clan or his family is the least in Israel, and he is the least in that family. He sees himself. You know, the nature of human nature, and Gideon at this point sees himself and defines himself by the past, by what has happened, by his stance in that community. You know, we do that too with others. We evaluate ourselves by our past, and we identify ourselves by the past. You know, if I go to an AA meeting, I start off with, my name is Wallace, and I'm an alcoholic. You know, or you may say that somebody else comes in here and says, oh, this is so-and-so. You know, he's the one who robbed the store down the road here back a few years ago. We define people by what has happened. But God don't. God defined Gideon by what he saw Gideon would do when he was filled with the Holy Spirit, or when God is in him and empowering him. And that is the way that we think about. God sees us differently than we see ourselves. We're not that type of person. We don't look at that way. You know, what God sees is the possibilities in a life when it's surrendered to God. And then as we look a little bit further in verse 13, it says, and we get to thinking about what's going on, it says, where is God in the middle of the oppressions of life? And in verse 13, he asked this question. He says, and Gideon said unto him, oh my Lord, if the Lord be with us, why then is all this befallen us? And where be all of the miracles which our fathers told us about, saying, did not the Lord bring us up out of Egypt? But now the Lord hath forsaken us and hath delivered us unto the hands of the Midianites. He said, where's God not with us? Where is God? Yeah, what Gideon is saying here, these odds are so vast, so major. Where is God in this? He don't deny that God has worked. He don't deny that there is a God, but he just says, God has forsaken us. I think when the children of Israel were standing at the edge of the Red Sea and Pharaoh's army was coming, and they cried out to God with these words, it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness. And Moses' response was, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Between the approaching army and the Red Sea, stand still. In the wilderness of sin, the same people that was there, they cried out to Moses again and said, would to God that we had died by the hands of the Lord in the land of Egypt, or when we sat at the flesh pots, and when we did eat bread to the full. For you have brought us forth into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger. Then God sends a manna for them to have. When Jesus was killed on that old rugged cross and laid in that buried tomb, things looked dark. All the hopes of the disciples had been dashed of what they had hoped and wanted for. But yet, resurrection day was coming. There was a resurrection day. And then Jesus appears and walks with them and talks with them and appears to them a number of times. And then he goes into heaven. He's gone again, and he's left a promise that there was for them to wait for the Holy Spirit. And they're waiting, and they're in this room, and they're together with one accord, but they're waiting. One day, 2 days, it extends to a week, and then on to the 10th day before the Holy Spirit comes upon them. It looks black, but God says, he's coming. You know, when our problems look like they're insurmountable, it is God's opportunity to deliver us. When it looks hopeless in your life and you feel like God has abandoned you, stand back and see the salvation of the Lord. There's 4 signs that God gives Gideon in these 2 chapters. Chapter 6 and 7. And we're going to look at one of those signs today. And he talks about that in verses 17 through 24. Let me just read just a little bit of it. And he said unto him, now Gideon's speaking here, and he said unto him, if I now have found grace in thy sight, then show me a sign that thou talkest with me. Depart not hence, I pray thee, until I come unto thee, and bring forth my present, and set it before thee. And he said, I will tarry until thou comest again. And Gideon went in and made ready a kid, an unleavened cake, and an ephah of flour. And the flesh he did put into a basket, and he put the broth in a pot, and brought it out to him. Put it under to him that was under the oak and presented it to him. And the angel of the Lord tells him, says, put it here on this rock. You know, here he is, he's asking for a sign. Show me a sign, Lord. If you are God, if you are the angel of the Lord speaking to me here this morning, show me a sign. So he asked him, said, put it here on this rock. And he lays that bread, he lays that basket of meat, and he says, pour the broth out over it, and he pours the broth out. And the angel of the Lord takes his staff and reaches it out to that altar. And flame comes out of the rock. That's amazing to me. Flame don't come out of the rod to consume it. Because he says that it comes out of the rock. Gideon's goat, the goat that he had prepared, and the sign that he was seeking was that he wanted to know that it was really God who spoke. And before the canon of scriptures and before this time, that they needed some sort of a witness, and God provided a sign to let him know that God was there. But when the Spirit of the Lord speaks to us in that still, small voice, we have something that's better than a sign. Because we can go back to his word, his written word, because the Spirit will never direct us to do something that's not recorded in his word. It will never contradict his word, He will never contradict what he has already written down, because God cannot contradict himself. So we have that assurance of that sign. Laying this doubt aside, Gideon makes some changes happen. It says, then he built an altar unto the Lord and called it Jehovah Shalom. The the Lord is peace, is what that means. As soon as he saw this, he says, I will build an altar here unto the Lord. I will build an altar unto the Lord. Now he's directed to do something here in just a minute. But I wonder when he calls this altar Jehovah Shalom, or the Lord is peace, if he felt like Jacob. You know, when he was sending his family on and he was in that tent alone and he wrestles with that man of God overnight and he throws his heel out and his name is changed that night, remember, from Jacob to Israel. And he makes this statement, Jacob does it, he does that. I have seen God face to face and my life is preserved. You know, you must hear and think about no man has seen God and live. And here he says, I have seen. And I wonder if Gideon felt that same way. And then the man gives him some directions. He says, so I want you to tear down the altar to Baal that your father has. Catch that? Not just the people have, but his dad had. Tear down that altar of Baal to your father has, and cut down the wooden images that is beside of it. And that's in verse 25. He tells them to do that. Second, I want you to build an altar to the Lord your God on top of this rock, the rock that he had had, that he had sown and burned up. Prepare that bull for the sacrifice, third and then fourth. Offer a burnt sacrifice. Now catch this in verse 26, say the last part of it. It said, offer a burnt sacrifice with the wood of the image which you shall cut down. Those images, that wooden poles that were raised up to this goddess, this false god, this false image, God says, use that. Burn that to make the sacrifice to the true and living God. Burn that. Wow. I think about that so often, or not so often. I thought about it as I prepared this message, and I wonder just how would that apply? You know, I've heard the question, you know, if Keith won the lottery and he wanted to give a tenth of that money to the church, would we accept it because it's gambling money from games of chance? You know, I wonder if this verse wouldn't tell us that, you know, even what was meant for bad can be used for good. I don't know. That's just a thought. But I just wonder about that. And then I think of it this way too. That when he knows that it's God, he follows the directions that he's given. And I think of 2 Chronicles. And I bet a lot of people will have this message out here tomorrow or next week. 2 Chronicles 7:14, so familiar to us. If my people, which are called by my name, now listen to this, shall humble themselves. That's the first thing that Gideon had to do. He had to realize that the altars, the pagan gods, they were wrong. He had to humble himself. He had to pray. They had to seek God's help in what was going on. Seek his face, to turn to God and turn from their wicked ways. And then, of course, it says, then I will hear from heaven and forgive their sins and will heal their land and start you. Just a few final thoughts. Sin separates us from God. There's a Bill Gaither, not the singer. It's Gaither instead of Gaither. Bill Gaither had a seminar that lasted a week throughout the country, different places. And I was fortunate enough to attend it a couple of times. And the name of the seminar was Basic Youth Conference. And one of the things that he illustrated a lot with little small drawings on the overhead. And anyway, one of the things that he drew a picture of is, you know, God's grace. And he pictures God's grace as being an umbrella. And when we're standing in God's grace, that rain of Satan that comes down upon us just rolls off and goes to the side. But if we hold that umbrella to the side, if we're able to step out from under the God's protection, we're not immune to the attacks of Satan. Sin separates us from God. In your eyes, you may seem weak. I seem weak. But God's eyes sees it this way. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. That's in Philippians chapter 4, 13. In hopeless situations, it's that opportunity that the curtain of God is opened and we behold His power and His glory and His majesty. Then, after we confirm God's word, that still small voice that we're hearing that's leading us, we need to obey. We need to follow it. If God says it, we are to be doing it. And then, lastly, to overcome the enemies, we must examine our own life and turn from our ways, wicked ways. We need to be turning from the wicked ways of our nation. We need to repent of the sins that we have entered into. The sins of taking life of an unborn child. The sins of just opening the floodgates to sexual immorality. The sins that we see around us on a day-to-day basis. We need to repent. And I say we need to repent because I'm not saying that you're doing it, but we're complacent to it. We need to be asking God to intervene and to use us. Even though you may feel like, what little can I do? Gideon hiding in a wine press. Hiding in a wine press, treading wheat. You know, and God says, you're a mighty warrior. God is saying to you, you're a mighty warrior. What you do can make a difference. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we love you and adore you, and we thank you. We thank you for the grace and mercy that you've shown upon us. Praise and honor. Pray that you'll take the words spoken and use them for your glory. And I pray that the folk that both here and in the parking lot will take and read not only chapter 6, but chapter 7, and put it all together before we come back together again. And Lord, we thank you and praise you. Even though the odds seem insurmountable, coming against your people. Lord, it's not beyond your capabilities. For in the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen.
Amen.